Fritz Springmeier 1998 Toronto Radio Interview about Mind Control and the Illuminati. Podcast 3 of 3. Wayne Morris as host interviews Fritz Springmeier. Continues. Host. One of the side effects apparently is extra low frequency energy that is reflected back to Earth, which is the frequency that our brain operates on. What typically would these companies use mind-controlled slaves for? Fritz. Sensitive projects that have to be kept under wraps by the New World Order. The production of railcars to haul civilians to concentration camps. Our government has kept the concentration camp project pretty low-key. Host. So, these people would be used to work on these projects and the company ensuring that they don't talk about it outside. You spoke of the Illuminati being an extension of mystery religions, and I wonder if you could tell our listeners what were the mystery religions, and what was their role in history. Fritz. You have asked two questions. One of the people who is well worth quoting is Manly P. Hall. He is both a Grand Master Illuminati and a Grand Master in the Freemasons. In his book, The Secret Teachings of All Ages, he said that the mystery religions were the channel through which the light to mankind was disseminated. P.29, the mystery religions claimed to the ancient world that they had revelation knowledge that would help enlighten and save people. They claimed that by joining them, and then going through the secret rituals, that you would elevate yourself. They claimed that you would become divine, or that you would reunite with your divine self if you went through the rituals and got to the highest, deepest levels of their secrets. That's what they were telling people on the outside. There are a lot of different ways to look at a phenomenon, and I want to bring in a couple of other angles. First, Swinburne Clymer, a high-ranking Freemason and Rosicrucian leader, said that there was a secret body that ruled and controlled all the various ancient mystery religions in the ancient world, Europe, Egypt, Babylon, clear over to Indian. You can read this claim in his book Ancient Mystic Oriental Freemasonry on p. 84-85. I can agree with him. What he is referring to here, the one secret body that will control all the various mystery religions, was what we call today the Illuminati. The Illuminati is the continuation of that secret controlling body. Freemasonry is the outer symbology of the ancient mystery religions. But if you want the hardcore rituals of the ancient mystery religions, those are the ones that are performed by the Illuminati. And what was their role in history? They played an exceptionally role in history. If one thinks about the power that kings have, who are kings dependent on? Kings must work through other people, and they are dependent on their advisors, and their financiers. You can't have a king going off and making a war unless he has money. So he is depending on those financiers. The financiers are dependent on trade and production of goods. The mystery religions, or secret societies, had so much power because they controlled the trade guilds with the trade secrets on how to produce the different goods. For instance, the art of making armor, or the art of making a longbow, or the art of making a Venetian warship, or getting closer to home. The roots of Freemasonry go back to the Masonic Builders Guild, and the architectural knowledge to design and build a cathedral was controlled by trade guilds, which were controlled by these mystery religions, these secret societies. You could be the king of a country, but you were still under the control of these mystery religions and secret societies. The man who supposedly converted the Roman Empire over to Christianity was the head of the Mitra mystery religion. They have played an extremely powerful and important part in history. They have controlled the priesthood and the trade guilds. But, also, there are a couple of ways they have played a continuous role in history, in that they have guided human endeavors, because the Illuminati, the mystery religions, have what they call the keepers of the great plans. That's not just my own opinion. Manly P. Hall, the Illuminati kingpin, in at least one of his books, goes into how the mystery religions of the great plan to bring in this great new world order. Host. What was this great plan? Fritz. Part of it goes back to the idea of the golden age of the millennium. That's an important concept for me to talk about. I will be stepping on a few people's toes here. Your Christians are really unaware of where their concept of the millennium came from. They think that it comes from the Bible, but if they go back historically, they will see that William Miller, who started the Adventist movement and started talking about millennium, was a high-ranking Freemason. He predicted that Christ would return in 1844. The question is, did Christ return in 1844? Most people, because we have a limited perspective on things, would say no, he didn't. But there was a man called Nabob who appeared in Persia, and he said, "I am Christ," and he started the Baha'i religion. He fulfilled William Miller's prophecy. The Freemasons were the ones who introduced the Baha'i religion to America, and they did it through the Chicago Masonic Temple around the turn of the century. The Baha'i religion is committed to a one-world government, a new world order, and a one-world religion. There was this Masonic Oriental Order of the Magi, and they were the hardcore group within the Chicago Masonic Temple who started the Baha'i religion in this country. These are the kinds of things that I try to expose so that people see how this all interconnects. A very brilliant man, James H. Billington, who was the librarian of the Library of Congress, wrote a book, Fire in the Minds of Men, and the Illuminati didn't realize what he was doing. He kind of blindsided. He was a member of the Council of Foreign Relations, so he is one of them. They thought he was one of theirs. This book goes through and it talks about where the word revolution came from. It came from the occult societies. The word revolution, which we use today to mean armed rebellion, didn't have that meaning in the beginning. The way it began to be used to mean armed rebellion to overthrow the old order and establish something new, was because occult societies, like the Freemasons who had been behind all of the revolutions of modern history from the American Revolution on, have all been created by the Freemasons and the Illuminati. Billington goes back in and traces how all the revolutions were started by this occult elite. The term revolution came from the occult idea that we were going to revolve ourselves back to the Golden Age. There is this great quest for the Golden Age, this millennialism. That's what communism is about. If you look at the early founders of communism, they were trying to revolve us back through revolution to the Golden Age that had been lost. Host. What was their idea of what a Golden Age consisted of? Fritz. Socialized communistic type society. This is why when you read Masonic prophets, like H.G. Wells, who wrote a number of books on how the New World Order could be brought about, the Fabian Socialists, etc., who have all these detailed plans, it's always for a socialistic, communistic type utopia. Host. But with a fascist leadership, it seems. Fritz. Yes. Laughs, on the surface it sounds really hunky-dory. It sounds really great. But it ends up more like Animal Farm and George Orwell. Host. I would also like to talk about what the relation of intelligence groups such as the CIA, the DIA and the MI6 is to the Illuminati. Fritz. There's a very close relationship. You will notice with MI6, in the first few decades of their existence, they came into existence at the turn of the century, they hired only women who came from elite Illuminati families. If you were a female working with MI6, you were referred to as Queenie, and they really were Illuminati queens. We go back and look at who set up these organizations, who runs these organizations. Look at the CIA for instance. People that understand what the Council for Foreign Relations is all about and how that's an Illuminati front will understand better what I am talking about. You look at Dulles, McCone, Helms, Schlesinger, Bush, Turner, Casey, you just go down your list of directors of the CIA, and they were members of the Council for Foreign Relations. Not only that, but they were members of other organizations that are Illuminati fronts. Turner was a Rhodes Scholar, which is an entry point for Illuminati. The Astors helped found the Rhodes Scholars. Casey and McCone, both of whom were Knights of Malta. Look at the membership of the Knights of Malta, 50% black nobility. I am talking about black in the context of the black, Guelph, European aristocratic bloodlines. The black, Guelphs, were a very powerful bloodline that have controlled Europe for many centuries. General Walter Bedell Smith was head of the CIA, From 1950 to 1953, working in U.S. intelligence, he was one of the co-founders of the Bilderbergers. Prince Bernhard, Illuminati, was the chairman of the original Bilderbergers. One of the late chairs was Peter Rupert, Lord Carrington, was Order of St. John, which is the Protestant version of the Knights of Malta. He was a director of a number of the Rothschild organizations like the Rio Tinto Zinc Corporation. He was a member of the Order of the Garter, which is very significant, and a member of the Order of Osiris. The Order of the Garter is one of the primary organizations which was given the responsibility to be in charge of the plans to bring in the New World Order by the Illuminati, and to give continuity from one generation to another. The Order of the Garter is extremely powerful. Your coat of arms, etc., is all controlled by the Order of the Garter, which is set up in covens of 13, groups of 13. If you have ever looked at heraldry, you will know how important this is. The Bilderbergers is also set up in groups of 13, the inner committee is 13. Host. Henry Kissinger is a prominent member of the Bilderbergers. What is his involvement in that group, to your awareness? Fritz. I don't know that he is a member himself, but he is a member of MI6, he has been a member of P2 Freemasonry, involved with a lot of things. He is a big player for them to implement their agenda. I do not know whether he's an actual member within the Illuminati or not, but he has sure been a big player. In fact, one day I listened to Henry Kissinger speaking and he said, "We will get a new world order. We may not get it in our generation, but if we do not get it in our generation, we will get it in the next generation." In other words, they are just going to keep trying. That's what the Order of the Garter has been assigned to do. When we look at these different intelligence groups, like the KGB and the CIA, we think we are looking at two groups that are fighting a covert war against each other. However, that is only what we are meant to see. There is a recent book by a Colonel Corsell, Day After Roswell. His book is eye-opening in many ways, in fact it may be hard to get after a little while. There seems to be a movement to suppress it. In his book he talks about how the CIA and the KGB are essentially one organization, and this was back in the 50s. He was tailed by CIA agents even though he was a colonel in the US Army, he's got the CIA spying on him, trying to find out what he is doing. He has to keep secrets from the CIA. I had an acquaintance whose father is high up in the CIA and he said when he was a teenager, one day his father came by and dropped a bombshell on him in that he couldn't even understand what his father was talking about. His father said out of the blue that the Cold War was a hoax. This teenager who had bought into the appearances the common people are supposed to accept was really confused. He didn't understand. He said it took him years to understand what his father was secretly referring to. We see these different groups and they appear to be different teams. But it's sort of like coming up to a football field and seeing two teams playing each other, you can't automatically assume they are not from the same school. It may be a scrimmage or an intervarsity game. You will see the hidden hand of the Illuminati in the creation of both the CIA and the KGB. In MI6 you will see Lord Victor Rothschild running things, Admiral Sir Hugh Sinclair, the Sinclairs are one of these families. MI5, which is internal security for Britain, their first Director General for many years was Major General Sir Vern Keel. He was a Freemason, and a number of other Director Generals of MI5 have also been Freemasons and also have been tied to these other organizations. The Director of MI5 during World War II was Knights of Grace of St. John. You could go on and on showing the overlapping connections. If you look at Alan Dulles, who was the director of the CIA from 1953 to 1961, you will see his role with Hitler prior to World War II, working with the international financiers, the bankers of these Illuminati kingpins. You will see his connections to the elite. Host. And certainly, the information about the CIA facilitating the flight of Nazi war criminals to North America, Dulles was involved in that. Fritz. Dulles was the man the Illuminati used to inform Hitler that the financiers would support him in his bid for power. He was the guy who brought the good news to Hitler, "Hey, You can go for it, we will finance you. Host. I would like to talk about another CIA director who was actually recently in Toronto accepting an honorary degree at the University of Toronto, George Bush. I wondered if you could talk about his affiliation with Skull and Bones. Fritz. Skull and Bones is an entry point into the Illuminati. Researchers have noticed the Skull and Bones, but there are a lot of other organizations which are entry points. Rhodes Scholars, a group in Oxford, there are a number of different fraternal organizations. Skull and Bones is not the only one, but that's the one George Bush joined. There is also Scroll and Key, Resilius, and some other fraternal organizations. One of the things George Bush did in his initiation ceremony for Skull and Bones was to lie in manure and recount all of his sexual exploits. Host. I understand that's an initiation ritual for all members of Skull and Bones. Fritz. Right. Host. You mentioned at the top of the interview that George Bush was related to some royal family, is that the House of Windsor? Fritz. He is a distant relative of Prince Charles and Queen Elizabeth. It's a distant relationship. Host. In your opinion, what has George Bush's role been in attempting to implement a global government? Fritz. He's been a criminal, and he has provided leadership for criminal activity. He's been involved with creating wars, with drug running, with pornography and mind control. Host. Are you aware of any information that George Bush is also a pedophile? Fritz. Oh yeah. Kathy O'Brien, for instance, who I have visited with, her daughter spent time with George Bush, and other people that are familiar with the mind control and what's going on have also said that the man was a pedophile. Host. Do you think that people in groups trying to bring about global control are planning a takeover attempt at a certain point in time, or do you think they will continue this new world order more gradually as they have been doing through expanded economic blocks and so forth? Fritz. It's a combination of gradual, spiced with some cataclysmic events. From the vantage point of being a planner, and having the actual plans and details, you would see that things are being implemented on a continuous basis. For instance, I have mentioned previously that the Panama Canal and Suez Canal were planned by the Illuminati back around 1800, if not before. Those were things they wanted to implement on the way to a new world order. When you see cataclysmic events occur, let's say there is a nuclear exchange or aliens all of a sudden arrive, they seem cataclysmic and instantaneous to those of us who are the common people. But the planning for these events has gone on for a long time. So yes, it will be gradual, if you are looking at the implementation of these plans, but the appearance of some of these things will be rather cataclysmic. In order to bring in the new world order as they would like to implement it, they want us to ask them to bring in what they want. So, for instance, in World War II, when the Japanese attacked Pearl Harbor, the Americans wanted to give away their freedoms to make their government more powerful. They will be implementing things that will cause us to ask us to do what they want to do. Host. What kinds of scenarios are possible? Fritz. For instance, in Australia, where this madman went in and he gunned down a lot of innocent people, children and families, boy. Right after that they ramrodded through gun legislation and approximately 500,000 weapons were turned in without a fight by the Australians because of this horrendous massacre that took place. The same things are going to happen in this country, and on this surface, it's going to appear like this is just a madman who flipped out and he gunned down a lot of people. But from their vantage point, they have spent a lot of years planning and programming. Host. And one could argue that it has already started to happen in terms of things like the Oklahoma City bombing and bringing in the counter-terrorism bill immediately after. Fritz. Yes. Exactly. I would say yes to both aspects. It will be both gradual and it will have a cataclysmic impact. Host. How, in your opinion, could mind control be used in one of these scenarios to create cataclysmic events? Fritz. I use the term New World Order, but you could also use World Order because the same people who are bringing in the New World Order have actually been controlling the world all along. it's really not new at all, it's just going into a more intense phase where the control is going to be more intense, and the mind control is going to be more pervasive and powerful. These people have been controlling things from behind the scenes for a long time. We go back and look at the power the British Empire had and the power that the French Empire had, and you ask yourself, well, who was running the British Empire and the French Empire? And you see the same people, the same families. I had mentioned earlier how many American presidents were related and how we have really been controlled by these oligarchic families here in the USA. Host. How would mind control possibly be used in a takeover scenario? Fritz. One way that it could be used is if people look at the Charles Bronson movie, Telethon, you will see the end result of this mind control. A housewife is called, given a fairy tale ditty, and she goes out and blows up a military installation. There are a lot of people with programming to do acts of sabotage and assassination. There are a lot of things that have to be accomplished. The weakest link in the chain is going to bust, and in order to implement all of these things from behind the scenes, you have to have mind-controlled people salted in at all different levels to ensure that nobody reveals the secrets, that people do the job they are supposed to, that people forget the things they are supposed to forget. For instance, banking, in the last few years a lot of banks have gone bankrupt. That has been very quietly covered over by bank mergers. A bank goes belly up, they will bring in a bigger bank and swallow it up and call it a merger instead of a bankruptcy. How do they keep these things secret? I know some programmed multiples personally working in the banking system, and I do not know the full extent of what these people are used for, I can only speculate. They are definitely using mind-controlled slaves within the banking system to hide their manipulations. Host. Quite a number of victims of mind control have spoken about end times programming. What can you tell us about that? Fritz. The end times programming refers to programming geared to bringing in new world order and the reign of the Antichrist. It has a lot of color programming. The list of people who are to be dealt with includes a red list comprised of those who are anti-New World Order opposition leaders who are to be executed about 2 weeks before martial law. The blue list are people who are against what is being done, but they are going to attempt to program them, arrest them to see if they can correct their thinking. Probably a lot of them will be killed in the midst of reprogramming. The final list, the yellow list, is people who will be rounded up for re-education camps after martial law. In the programming there are yellow flags at half-mast, yellow dog on run, blue fish at home, and I know this from work with mind control victims. Color codes are used because they will be using a lot of mind control slaves, including foreign troops, e.g. Russians, to implement these things. It is easier to use color coding. Things will be implemented with activation codes which also use color codes, e.g. blue ray, red ray, purple ray, green ray. Those will go to team leaders. If the listeners are familiar with MWA, they understand uplines and downlines. A team leader can have perhaps four people under him, he calls them, each of them calls four people. Those will be color-coded. Each one of the EG4 will have a color, blue ray, red ray, purple ray, green ray. And then some of the sites are color-coded. Internally within the minds of the slaves, some of them have internal crystals. These crystals are timed. They could also be rocks. They are timed to explode or release certain programming at a certain point in time. These crystals will have color codes as well. If the therapist begins getting into end-time programming, that's one of the things they are going to notice. They are also going to notice mountaintops are used quite a lot for meeting place or significant places. A lot of international cooperation is involved in their plans and programming. Common news events are oftentimes triggers, e.g. Lady Diana dying, Princess Di's death caused certain mind control slaves to trigger off that news event. End times programming also involves, because of the ushering in of the reign of the Antichrist, demonology involved, the demon person involved with the programming. His job is the revelator of the Antichrist. He will know a victim system. You will see Apollo, son of Apollo, is the Antichrist, so Apollo is the father of the Antichrist. You will see Aesculapius, he is the demon of healing. You see a lot of healing going on in the charismatic movement. Some of the ministers in this movement are actually Satanists, and I know from eyewitnesses that in secret they carry out satanic rituals where they attempt to gain the power of Aesculapius, which is a demonic healing power. When they go into these churches, they use mind control and this demonic healing power to heal Christians and then tell people God healed you. They don't state to them which God. Another aspect that is characteristic to the end times programming is the involvement of the aliens. A lot of alien programming, plans with aliens, and a whole series of programming categories related to catastrophes. I am now speaking to therapists. When you get into the part of the system that is involved with end times catastrophes, you will get into working with __. And another area involves a lot of computer control of people. And I am still only in the beginning of understanding all of this. There is an actual computer at 666 Connecticut Avenue in Washington, D.C., which is called the Janus II computer. When victims start spewing out their programming, they start talking about the Janus coding, which has something to do with tracking and reprogramming, and ties in with computers. Then there is the ambassador coding. Subcodes include setting fires, suicide, doing an act of violence against somebody. Emperor coding. Morse coding. Host. What in a general sense would they be programmed to do? Fritz. We are not talking about just running drugs or prostitution, we are talking about control of society as a whole. One of the scarier options they have is to bring in a mock alien invasion. They will have flying saucers with aliens arrive. Because they control so many different aspects of society, even though a number of people like myself would say beware of this, beware of that, we would be drowned out by this orchestra of people in different sectors of society, congressmen, newsmen, religious leaders, saying whatever the plan is for them to say. Of course there will be controlled opposition. There will be a few people saying, I distrust these aliens, or this agenda, or what the government is doing, but they will be controlled opposition who will gather all the opposition to what they want to do and raise the hopes of people who are against this hidden agenda but will not actually carry through and stop it. Host. Do you believe that the governments of the world have UFO technology that they have been developing? This alien invasion would be a staged invasion using their own military technology. Fritz. There is no question in my mind about it. Another agenda they have is to destroy faith in national governments. That has been divided into thousands of different projects. Jehovah's Witnesses who go door to door. If you look at their literature, it works very hard at destroying faith in nationalism. But who would suspect the Jehovah's Witnesses? Their Watchtower Society is actually an Illuminati front. In fact, one of their members accidentally stumbled onto a big clue to this. He noticed there were thousands of hidden occult symbols in the Watchtower artwork. There would be a picture of a waterfall in a Watchtower magazine, but when you looked at it really closely, you would realize it was a skull. It's like Currier and Ives used to have these hidden pictures, look at a tree and see other pictures. They have these occult messages hidden in the Watchtower literature, like a goat leading a herd of sheep, things like that. Or a thief running off with occult jewelry with an all-seeing eye and things like this. They have a lot of hidden messages. Who would think of Jehovah's Witnesses being used? They use JWS to access some of their slaves. Who can go door to door without suspicion? I brought Cisco out of the Illuminati. It doesn't mean I am the only person who ever helped her, but these JWS will come to the door, and I will say, no, don't answer the door. Her natural inclination would have been, oh, they are just Jehovah Witnesses. Interestingly, the same couple who came to our door, to try to talk to Cisco, showed up the next day clear across town at another victim's doorstep. Very strange. I know the Jehovah Witnesses from the inside and how they map out their territories and how they go door to door, and what happened was not normal. You had to have a team of people who were trying to access slaves that were getting free, and their cover was to be Jehovah Witnesses. It sounds like I am getting a little bit off track, but what I am trying to say is, it is in their objective to destroy faith in the national government. How do you destroy a national government? You create civil war, create distrust of that government, bankrupt that government. There are all these different projects to bring down the American government, and bring down respect for our government. They play both ends against the middle. Implementation of the end times agendas involves a lot of agendas and a lot of people scurrying around doing different things until you see the whole picture and how it all fits together. It just looks like a lot of chaos. Host. I wanted to come back to your point about them creating a chaotic situation, such as some of the scenarios you have been talking about. In order for the public to then ask for the military to step in, or for the United Nations to step in, and basically ask for a state of martial law, is that your take on how they are going to do this? Fritz. We will ask them for what they want to do. People have sat in on Illuminati meetings where they gave their 20-30-40-year plans. The key word to all of those plans was that it would happen naturally, as if it was naturally happening. In order to implement that, you have a lot of mind-controlled slaves out there. Another example, they want to destroy the continuity of religious beliefs in the USA. The USA was basically founded by a Protestant majority. There were very few Catholics when the USA was started. In other words, the people of this country had a common agreement, one outlook on morality. Fritz. When people have a moral belief system, Buddhist or whatever, if it's a very strong belief system, it's hard to change them. What they are trying to do is fragment our belief system. They have brought in a lot of foreign belief systems into the USA, but you also have all of these New Age gurus popping up and creating their own little New Age groups. In the bigger picture, it's to destroy the fabric of a unified moral response, and a lot of these New Age leaders, e.g. Elizabeth Clare Prophet, Church Universal and Triumphant, are mind-controlled slaves. Jay-Z Knight, that's who she goes by, the entity she channels, she's a mind-control slave. These are New Age leaders and they are gathering flocks. One of the gals who became a friend of mine who left the CUT and became a Christian, in having worked with her, I noticed some red flags that maybe she, as one of the leaders of Elizabeth Clare Prophet's group, was a mind control victim, and she's not the only evidence I have that not only are the leaders under mind control who start the groups, but part of their flocks are mind control victims who are being programmed to join these cults. Imagine if you are a religious leader and you get secret help from the establishment and you have people being programmed to join your organization, how that gives you an edge over you or I starting a religion. So that's one reason why we have such a chaotic religious atmosphere out there, where all of these gurus and religious leaders are starting all these small weird groups. Host. You talked about Dr. Ewan Cameron as being one of the mind control programmers. I would like to know specifically what his and McGill University's contribution to the development of trauma-based mind control is, to your awareness. Fritz. I don't know that I have a great deal to share. I know that St. Mary's Hospital there in Montreal was used by these people for programming. In the basement they had what was known as the zombie room, and an isolation room and the grid room. From various victims of mind control I know that various Catholic Church institutions were used in Quebec. As far as Cameron's personal contribution, I know that he worked for years assisting in the programming and research. The things that he researched were classified, and I don't have a good grasp of what he discovered. I know that if we read Journey into Madness by Gordon Thomas, in a couple of places in his book he makes fun of Dr. Cameron. He says that Cameron's grants hadn't produced any tangible value to the CIA, or that there was a Dr. Gottlieb who was supposedly investigating the doctor and questioning whether Cameron had done anything to help the agents. I consider those kinds of statements the typical kind of CIA disinformation that is put out. They typically say we did research but we didn't find anything of value. I have a hard time believing that Dr. Cameron, who was on the leading edge of mind control and who was in touch with the top mind control programmers of his day and learning techniques from them, that the man was of no value to the CIA. I am not trying to put down Gordon Thomas's book because I would recommend it to people, but this is the type of disinformation that spews forth from so many different sources. Why was he head of the prestigious American Psychiatric Association, and the World Psychiatric Association? Why was he put in charge of so many very powerful organizations by the establishment if he was so worthless to their agenda? Host. Just in a general sense, what were the types of institutions that were involved in the development of mind control across North America? Fritz. Good question. I can quote them. Admiral Stansfield Turner, on August 3, 1977, told a Senate investigating committee that in the USA, prisons, pharmaceutical companies, hospitals, 44 medical colleges, American universities, and corporations were helping the CIA carry out the mind control experiments. I believe that using the word experiments is a little bit of disinformation. This was operational programming. They were taking the people who were coming out of these mind control experiments and using them. They were far more than just experiments. But those were the kind of institutions that were assisting in the programming. Host. Can you make a statement about the role of psychiatry in the development of mind control? Fritz. They have been very important to develop the mind control from being more what we would call training to being placed on a very scientific basis. There has been extensive research into the mind by psychiatrists. That research has been invaluable for developing the mind control technologies. Behavior modification, Skinner, Pavlov, etc., findings were directly implemented in teaching various alters to do certain things. If you read our Volume 2 book and the Deeper Insights book, I go into how each of the different alters are created, i.e. gatekeepers. At some point a gatekeeper alter will be taken to a door and then using behavior modification techniques, severely torturing the alter, they are taught not to step beyond the door, but hold their place at that door. The research that shows that this type of training would be effective came from behavior modification and psychiatrists. Host. Do you think that some psychiatrists may have been unwitting in helping develop this technology? Fritz. There are several different levels of participation. People who are just plain evil, people who are coerced, blackmailed, mind control victims themselves, then a level of people below that who are unwitting dupes of the system. My father was never part of the system in the sense of he never joined any occult societies, he is not in favor of a new world order, philosophically he's not aligned with them. He's just somebody who believes in science and he believes science can help the world. He wanted to help the world, make a positive difference. The Illuminati deflect what these researchers want for good and use it for evil purposes. I have a hard time with one scientist I was talking with earlier this year. He developed biological weapons for the USA, viruses, anthrax, etc. He said knowledge is neutral, it is neither good nor bad. It's how it's used. I am thinking in my head, are you that stupid, that you don't realize the people you are working for and who are going to use this stuff are going to use it for evil? A lot of these scientists are so focused on the tiny little details of what they are trying to research, and ego plays a part in this. They want to discover something, their ego, pride, concentration in the research doesn't allow them to step back and say what is this going to be used for. Host. The information that we have been talking about has been quite depressing, and I think a lot of people are going to be affected by it. What message of hope do you have for people after learning about all of this? Fritz. There are two sides to a coin, and we have been talking about the negative side of the coin. The positive side is that a lot of the technologies that have been developed could actually be used for the advancement of mankind, to benefit mankind. Another positive is that in spite of the forces that are trying to destroy humanity, there are a lot of positive forces. There are quite a number of independent researchers, and they haven't gotten much media attention except ridicule. People have been researching free energy, and they have made a lot of advancements, so the common person would not be dependent upon the establishment for any of its energy. Another area of research is alternative medicine. Amazing discoveries that really liberate people from establishment medicine. You have the internet and photocopy machines which have given the common person the ability to transmit and gather a lot of information without being part of the establishment. You have homeschooling. There are developments that are taking place that do not rely on the establishment monopolies. These monopolies are fragile and they can be broken. Another positive is that in spite of the monumental power they have, people like myself have been able to slip through their control cracks and have been able to free people from the deepest depths of the organizations. I have been able to get out so much information exposing their methods and their agenda. I am saying this to show these people are not invincible. Host. I would like to thank you very much for joining us on this radio series. It's been absolutely fascinating talking to you, and I would like to thank you for bringing this information out. Fritz. I very much appreciate this chance, and I want to congratulate your courage and your love for the truth in bringing this to the Canadian and the American people. Host. Stay tuned next week for an interview with Cisco Wheeler, Fritz Springmeier's co-author, and former Illuminati family mind-controlled slave. CBC TV is going to be airing a few productions on mind control this week. The Fifth Estate is supposed to be airing an investigation which was supposed to be about Montreal psychiatrist, Dr. Pivnicki, Mila Mulroney's father, and his role in covering up the Cameron mind control experiments. I am not sure if that's what is on this week, I don't know if they had to change that due to Brian Mulroney's attempt to clear his name. Also, 1 week today, Sunday, January 11th, 1998 at 8 to 10 p.m. will be part 1 of The Sleep Room, which is a documentary based on Ann Collins' book In the Sleep Room based on Dr. Ewan Cameron and his CIA-funded experiments on his psychiatric patients at the Allen Memorial Psychiatric Institute in Montreal. Dr. Cameron was the target of 2 lawsuits against the CIA and the Canadian government by his psychiatric patients who had been unwittingly involved in his experiments which involved electroshock, sensory deprivation, psychic driving, drugs, reportedly in an effort to wipe out a person.